Now I have somebody that you really need to meet. The ARC of California is just unbelievably lucky. For 13 years, we had Tony Anderson, who is actually here today. Thank you for being here, Tony. 13 years, for crying out loud, we had Tony Anderson. And it was the legendary Shirley Dove who found Tony. She was the president of the board back then, and she hired Tony to unify and build the organization, and man, did he ever do that. And we'll be honoring Tony tomorrow about 6:30 on the top floor of this building, saying officially goodbye to him for all of his work over the years. Goodbye. And a special reception we'll have tomorrow night, 6:30, so plan on being there. We're also lucky that Tony is still part of our community. He's still out there helping people with IDD because he is now head of a regional center in Stockton, the Valley Mountain Regional Center. Or is it Mountain Valley? Again, either way. Okay. But the breaking news is, ladies and gentlemen, we're also even, we're even luckier to have found his replacement, someone who generates as much confidence and enthusiasm in me and my board as Tony did with Shirley and her board 13 years ago. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to meet Jordan Lindsay. Welcome aboard. Let me just tell you quickly about Jordan. First of all, we met him when he served as the ARC of California's Director of Public Policy in 2007. And 2008. He also ran the ARC's very successful Partners in Policy Making program during that same time frame. We had a number of great candidates during the interview process, but Jordan stood out because of his understanding of the issues that are facing people with IDD and his ability to articulate a strategy to deal with those issues. And we also like the fact that he had some legislative background, having worked for Assemblymember Carol Liu. And we're very impressed with his subsequent experience and his education and his experience building coalitions. He received his MBA from the Haas School of Business at the University of California, Berkeley. Go Bears. As part of his new assignment, Jordan will head up the collaboration with UCP and will lead the Lanterman Coalition. Jordan, we want to welcome you to the ARC and can't really tell you at all how pleased we are to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks so much. And the voice on that, man, are you kidding me? I'm from Pasadena, and I don't know why. This is the first time I've heard you, Richard, on a microphone, I think. And I don't know why my voice keeps going to the Rose Parade like an announcer. And the Ark and UCP float coming through with roses and carnations. I don't know. It's a brilliant voice. I'm so jealous and envious of that. Thank you for that warm welcome to all of you. I really want to thank the board of directors for putting me in this position and trusting me to fulfill the big shoes that Tony has left and to help lead the ARC and this organization to greater and amazing things, and that's what I am here to do. And I also want to thank the amazing people who put together the conference here. I started working last Wednesday, and it was a bit of walking into a fire hose with the conference coming up, and there was just a couple things happening and healthcare reform in D.C. And so I am so lucky that there have been such capable people like Betsy and Pat and so many on the board who have put this together. I also want a huge thanks to Tim Hornbecker, who made a seamless transition for me coming in and helping between Tony and I very capably taking care of the Lanterman Coalition, the ARC of California, the collaboration with UCP, and hand that over to me so well. So thanks to all of you. And of course, most importantly, thanks to each and every one of you that came on a Sunday and a Monday to come up to Sacramento and be here. This from right here is a fantastic view, seeing advocates from all different sides of this community here together to be nerdy on policy and to really try to get armed with the latest information so that you can go back to your communities, your families, your providers, your agencies, your regional centers, and be well equipped to continue your advocacy efforts. So this is a fantastic view. And what's most impressive about the ARC is how we are able to work with agencies like United Cerebral Palsy, which this conference would not be possible without their partnership as well. And so we're so excited to continue working with them. And also being able to bring together lots of different organizations and parents and self-advocates and providers to really move the ball forward all together for the people that we are here to serve. And what I really want to just take a moment is, if we're getting pretty deep on policy and legislation and everything else, but if you are a parent of a person with an intellectual developmental disability, would you mind just standing for a moment? If you were a parent in the room, not to interrupt your eating, because what I think is most important, or raise your hand if you're unable to stand, but is you guys, and you guys, I hope that you continue to pressure everybody else to make sure that we have our eye on the ball and we know what we are advocating for. And so thank you guys, especially for being advocates that you are. And included in that is the self-advocates in the room as well. Thank you for continuing to be at the top of the pyramid, the top of the hierarchy, those who are continuing to advocate for not only yourselves, but making sure we all know what we're doing and make sure we're doing our job right. And for you parents in the room, we are incredibly lucky because we have one of the parents of all parents. There are a few moms in this country which inspire me to no end. One is Shirley Dove, who's here with us. And the other is our keynote speaker for this afternoon, Sue Swenson. And I had the privilege of introducing Sue 7-8 years ago when I was Director of Partners in Policymaking, as she gave a speech down in Bakersfield, and so I know how powerful her story is, and I also know how powerful the work she is doing is. Sue Swenson most recently served the Obama administration as Acting Assistant Secretary for Special Education and Rehabilitative Services. She currently serves as the Volunteer President-Elect of Inclusion International, which is the UN-recognized organization for children with disabilities, their parents, and adults with intellectual disabilities. Sue learned about disability and being a courageous mom and advocate from her son Charlie, who lived for 30 years with disabilities. We are very lucky, and indeed, will you please give a warm welcome to Sue Swenson.
Thank you very much. I think my mic is on. I hope it's working. The projector sector is very important. How's that? Is that working? Everybody can? Okay, good. I asked for this mic because I'm going to get off the stage because I can't stand standing up here. So I'll be wandering around, and I apologize for that, but that's who I am. I think when I was a parent advocate in Minnesota, I learned you got to be a moving target. Right? So I apologize to the gentlemen who have set up the cameras, but I'm going to be non-compliant. I am thrilled to be here with you today. I want to thank all of the sponsors of this fabulous meeting. I want to thank History. Shirley, when you first introduced me to Tony Anderson, I thought he was a young guy. Now I met Jordan, so. But it's wonderful to see the ARC has this built-in momentum of being able to seamlessly move between generations of leadership. 13 years is a long time to be in charge of an organization. And it will have your fingerprints on it. And you should be honored for those fingerprints. I know where the Monday morning memo came from. I'll let everybody else ask you about that. So, I first got involved with this field, and I'm going to tell you a lot of personal stories and some government stories. Yeah, I'm not a Fed anymore, so I can tell those. When my son Charlie was born in 1982, and Charlie was my second son, and Will was one of those little guys who could walk and talk when he was 9 months old, and Charlie couldn't hold his head up when he was 9 months old. And I was still trying to get the doctors to pay attention to him, even though he was big and healthy, there was something wrong, and they finally started looking at it, and they came back to me and said, well, he has muscular dystrophy. They did a muscle biopsy, and I said, oh, okay, I'll try to figure that out. And then I went back the next time and said, if he has muscular dystrophy, why is his left leg shorter than his right leg? And the neurologist said, madam, I assure you, I am a world-famous neurologist. I've measured his legs. His left leg is not shorter than his right leg. And I said, well, I'm making his clothes because he can't stand really stiff clothes. So I'm making all these soft little clothes. And his left leg is about 3/4 of an inch shorter. And he said, well, let me show you. And he took out his tape measure and said, oh, you're right. Raise your hand if you've heard that a lot of times. So that meant we had to go have a CAT scan. And the CAT scan of his head, well, they did the CAT scan. He screamed the whole time. Bill and I were sitting there waiting for it. The doctor came out and said, could you come back tomorrow? Because I have some important people here that I need to talk to. Today I don't have time to talk to you. But if you could come back tomorrow, then we can go through what the CAT scan shows us. And I said, sure. And I called my sister, who is a physician, and said, okay, tomorrow is Saturday. Why is he asking me to come back to the hospital on Saturday? And she said, I don't know the answer to that, Sue, but I'm going to come with you guys to the meeting. So Charlie in my arms, Will on my husband's hand, my sister Barb and I are sitting in the room, and the world-famous neurologist pulls out an x-ray film, puts it up on the light board, and says, oh, that can't be your son. That's a normal brain. And then he pulls out another one and sticks it up, and I could see that there were spots all the way through most of the right side of Charlie's brain. And I could literally, I don't know about those of you in the room who've gone through diagnosis, but I suspect a lot of you have felt this. I could literally feel myself falling into those holes. And I could feel my life changing, just like that. And it was brutal. I will tell you one good thing. I went back to Charlie's pediatrician, who was the man who had founded this large interdisciplinary clinic in Minneapolis that we went to. And I said, Dr. Lund, here's what happened to me with your neurologist. And he said, okay, wait, sit right there. Just don't move. Picks up the phone, he calls the said world-famous neurologist and says, we don't need people like you here, you're fired, I want you out by the end of the day. Now that wasn't anything I did. All I did was tell my story. All I did was tell the doctor the reality of what had happened to me in that little room on a Saturday. That's so important. So many people here have said to you already this morning, you must tell your story at the legislature. And that is so true. Now, I'm going to give you Popeil's pocket management tips for how to tell your story to the legislature. First, you can't bore somebody into understanding your point of view. And how I worked in the Senate for a year as a Kennedy Fellow. And I swear to God, some of the staff would take the phone and set it down on the table, and every now and then they'd go, uh-huh, and they'd keep working, because somebody would be going on and on and on and on about everything that was wrong. You can't do that. So first, you tell them what needs to change. Second, you give them a statistical or scientific fact about that. It can be anything. How many people have it, how many of your friends you know, but something statistical out of a really good newspaper is best. So if you've got something from one of the big California papers or what some of the national papers, that's good. Three, you tell them why you care about it. So that's where this is where your emotion comes from. Four, you repeat again what needs to happen, and you offer follow-up. May I contact your staff? May I provide any further information to you? May I help you make your mind up about how this is going to go forward? Now, this structure came from a man named Vince Covello, who was a journalism professor at Columbia University, which, as you know, was a preeminent journalism program in the world. He's the man who taught Oprah how to communicate. So that's why I like him, because, geez. His theory, and he tested this with audiences over and over again, is that trust equals caring plus credibility. You have to have both caring and credibility. If you're going in and all you're saying is, my life is going to be terrible if we don't change this, you're losing. You have to also say, give him some credible facts about why it needs to change. Covello also found that in most audiences in the United States, a man is given credit for being a credible person right out of the box. You walk into the room and everybody thinks you know what you're talking about. Well, you do. Whereas if you walk into the room, everybody thinks you have deep, passionate caring about the issue. He can get there if he talks about his caring. You can't get to 100%. You can get to 95%. And I can get to 95%. But you can't get all the way there as a woman. This is why when you go in a group of people into the legislator's office, I want you to have a team that has a couple of genders on it, right? As a woman, one of the things you can do to earn that credibility, oddly enough, isn't to repeat what your degrees are, it's to list your points. So, Senator, I only have three things I want to say to you today. One, this, two, that, and three, this. Because there is this gender assumption that the woman is going to start talking and, God, where is she going to end? Who, you know, I don't have much time. You can do this if you practice with key points of stuff that you want to get across. You can make this intervention in 90 seconds. I've timed it. I've trained people to do it. 90 seconds, you can walk down the hall with a member of your legislature and give him the key point. Now, what people don't know is that the follow-up is where the magic is. So we know, I'm by training a marketer, we know that it takes 7 contacts to change somebody's mind. 7. That doesn't mean you have to go walking into the office and knock on the door 7 times, but you can say to him, can I offer you some follow-up? And then, okay, this is classic partners. As soon as you've had the meeting, you write a thank you note, right? Thank you note is contact number 2, because you reiterate why you were there. Contact number 2. Then you send an article. This is the article I referenced when I was talking to you, or here are some letters from other people that I know. Send it to his staff if that's what he asked for. Then you call, that's contact number 3. Then you call to say, did you get the article? Was it useful? Is there anything else I can do for you? I would be happy to provide any information that you would like. I'll resend it. Do you want me to organize a small town hall? Do you want me to bring some people into your office? You see what I'm doing here. You just invent contacts. Not because you're trying to trick them into doing something, but because it is human nature to trust people that you have consistent contacts with. And members of your legislature, members of your congressional delegation are humans. I think, you know, they are. when Charlie was diagnosed, I took him down to Chicago, where I had gone to college. I studied with a guy named Richard McKeon, who, if anybody in the room study philosophy, or if you have a modern library Aristotle, it's McKeon's edition, even now. And he had had a stroke when he was in Venice. He was at the time 82 years old and was chairman of three world philosophical organizations all at the same time. When he was in Venice for one of these meetings, he had a small heart attack, and while he was in the boat taking him to the hospital, he had a stroke. So I came down to Chicago to see him with my husband and to tell him about our little guy. And he had lost most of the function on the left side of his body, and Charlie didn't have much function on the left side of his body. So I'm standing there crying, saying, "Professor, my son is really, really disabled, and his life is going to be very different now, and he can't really move the left side of his body." And McKeon said, "I guess we're just alike then." McKeon, if you Google him, there are people in the world who say this is the smartest guy who lived in modern times. He didn't say stuff like that carelessly or without meaning something by it. So when he said to me, "I guess we're just alike," I thought, I have to think more carefully about this. I have this 2-year-old, 15-month-old kid, and I have to think more carefully about what does it mean for him to have disabilities. One of the things McKeon did in his career was chair for UNESCO the team of world philosophers that put together the first Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And he worked with Mrs. Roosevelt to try to create the underlying principles of human rights. What are the principles that every culture in the world agrees on? That we're not going to write something that this group of people are going to say, "No, that's not something we can sign on to." So I had started, when I was his student, thinking about human rights. He used to take us down to Chicago to UN Day every October, and we would be thinking about human rights. But I was, 19. I thought human rights were something you gave to other people, right? I thought human rights were something that Americans worried about, whether other nations were letting their people enjoy human rights. And in my work in disability with my son Charlie, who, bless his heart, died at age 30 in January of 2013, in those 30 years of work, what I learned is it's all about human rights. It's hard to go into a member of your legislature and say, "Sir, I want to talk to you today about human rights in Fresno." But it's all about human rights. So my advice to you is learn the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. You can buy the app on the Apple Store for $1. Put it on your phone. It's not hard to read. There's key points. It begins by saying all human beings are born free and equal. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. There's a lot right there because it says all human beings. Now, the thing I wanted to talk about today is that's actually not language that was just pulled out of the sky by those guys working in Paris on the Universal Declaration all of those years ago. It came from really the brutal understandings that the world had at the end of World War II, when we looked around and said, we just realized that it is now possible to have mechanized war and mechanized industrial scale killing of innocent people. That's really what World War II first delivered to us, is this idea that you could have concentration camps and killing fields, and you just had a manager who pushed the buttons, and somebody said, yes, sir, I'll go ahead and do that. And it was industrial scale. It was man's inhumanity to man that forced us to really begin to understand what are human rights and what do they mean? Where do they come from? They are endowed. Well, what does that language sound like? To me, and actually the historians have said, it sounds like life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, right? So I started monkeying around on the Monticello website, because I'm weird. And, well, first I was looking for some seeds, and then I noticed that they had Jefferson's papers on the website. So I thought, huh, let me go see what those look like. And what I learned is something that I have never seen in a history book and never seen recognized by anyone. Thomas Jefferson had a younger sister who had intellectual disabilities. In the language of the times, she was an imbecile, which meant she probably had 5 to 10 words and could walk, but couldn't really be responsible for herself to care for herself. Her name was Elizabeth. She was 2 years younger than Thomas. She was his closest sibling and the one that he talked frequently about feeling the closest to in his life. She meant a lot to him. There were institutions in Virginia at that time. They were snake pits, but Elizabeth did not go to one of them. Elizabeth was raised at home with all of the other siblings. And here's the interesting part. When Thomas Jefferson's mother died, he wrote a letter to the Continental Congress organizers, to Madison and the other guys, and said, you know what, I can't work with you anymore because I'm now responsible for caring for my sister Elizabeth, whom I love. And then in 1774, there was a hurricane and an earthquake, just coincidentally at the same time in Monticello. And Elizabeth, who clearly had anxiety, became so agitated that she ran from the house. Now, raise your hand if the person with disability that you love would run from the house if there was an earthquake and a hurricane and they had never seen anything like it before, right? She ran from the house, was followed by her maid, and they found their bodies 2 weeks later drowned in the river. At which point, Jefferson wrote back to our founding fathers and said, sadly, I am now free to rejoin you in this work. That was 1774. So see, now I completely believe that when he wrote, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all people are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, he meant all people. Because if you're a parent of a person with a disability or you work closely with people with disabilities, the first thing you know about them is they're just like everybody else. Jefferson, I cannot imagine Jefferson would have written all if he didn't mean all. He usually was pretty good with words. What that means is the notion of inclusion of people with intellectual disabilities is in our founding documents in the United States. It's right there. That document and Jefferson himself went on to really inform the process in France to create the Statement on the Rights of Man. And that document and our declaration went on to inform the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Those are considered to be the three main organizing arguments about human rights in the world. Now, we now have the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the convention to eliminate all forms of discrimination against women, the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities, 3 United Nations conventions that are designed to explain the human rights of these special groups that the United States has not ratified. On the rights of the child, it's us and Somalia. We are the 2 countries that haven't ratified. Somalia, because they were engaged in child welfare up to their eyeballs at the time. They had kids as soldiers all over the place. Us, I don't know why we can't sign a UN convention. We sign them. I don't know why we can't ratify them. I sat in the chamber when they brought the vote on the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities to the floor. Were other people in the room in the chamber? So Bob Dole is sitting there. He was invited into the Senate chamber and sat in the front of the room because he had been to visit every single senator to make sure they would vote for ratification of the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. And all the Democrats voted for it, and all the Republicans looked right at him straight in the face and voted against it, even though the day before they told him they were going to vote for it. Who organized that? That was Ted Cruz, who organized that on behalf of the Koch brothers. So this was a sneaky way to give these Senate Republicans the message, if you vote for this, we're going to send a Tea Party candidate up against you. This is really serious. So the conventions don't give anybody any new rights. There's nothing in the Convention on the Rights of the Child that bestows any new rights on children around the world. What it does is explain what the Universal Declaration of Human Rights means in modern terms for children. And likewise, the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities, there's nothing new in there. If we ratified it, it's not like there would suddenly be all kinds of new litigation or anything else going on. All it is a modern explanation of what the Universal Declaration means for people with disabilities in the modern age, when we have communication devices and wheelchairs and all the other stuff that we didn't have when the Universal Declaration was first ratified in 1948. So I happen to have testified because, tell your story, right, at the UN when they were working on the CRPD. I went, I was working for the ARC at the time, the ARC US, as the assistant executive director, and I was sent to there, and I kept raising my hand. In the caucus room, there were like 400 geniuses with wheelchairs, right? And I kept raising my hand, and the 2 women running the meeting wouldn't call on me. So when it was all over, I went up to them and said, you know, one of them had depression and the other one had a pain syndrome. And I wasn't allowed to speak because I was just a parent. Well, then I said, well, then how is my son's voice supposed to be heard here? Because you guys are proposing some stuff that I think is not going to be helpful to people with complex disabilities. And the 2 women said, well, if he wants to be heard, he should come himself. And Charlie never spoke a word in his life. And he should come himself and his voice will be heard. And I said, well, that would be a miracle. And I got mad and huffed out of the room. And on my way home, I thought, if not me, who's going to do this? Some mother from sub-Saharan Africa who has a kid with profound disabilities is not going to bring him on an airplane to come to the UN and testify about this. So I made a few calls, and I got together with some other people. And lo and behold, I was on the next disability caucus meeting. I was on a panel. It was chaired by a man with intellectual disabilities, Robert Martin, who was the first self-advocate assigned to the convention committee right now. He's from New Zealand. and a woman from Canada who used a communication device, a young woman and her mom, and me and Charlie, and Charlie's assistant, Zach, and Charlie's brother, Will. And we were all supposed to be on this panel, and we were talking about legal capacity. And their proposal was, no person with a disability should ever have any kind of representation at all. They're completely in charge of their own life, and nobody needs a guardian. And we should just get rid of the whole concept of guardian. And I got up and said, well, you guys told me to bring Charlie and that he would speak for himself. I should tell you first, the reason I brought Zach is Zach was like 6'7", used to play football for Kansas. And then after he graduated from college, he went to New Zealand where he was a professional rugby player. And Zach and Charlie got along great. But the chair of this whole thing was from New Zealand. So. So anyway, I said, you told me I should bring Charlie and he would speak for himself, and I did that. And it was really hard to get here. It took all day yesterday to get up here, and it took all morning to get him over here. So if one of you would like to volunteer to take him to lunch when we're done, please raise your hand. And nobody raised their hand. And I said, so you're going to sit here and tell me you're going to write the rules for how my son is allowed to enjoy his rights in life. And you don't even understand enough about him to be able to take him to lunch. Right? I think I even called them 400 geniuses in wheelchairs. So I said, you told me to bring him and he would speak for himself, so I brought him. Charlie, what do you have to say? And it was the longest, like 3 or 4 minutes of my whole life. Because I just stood there while he went, looked at his hand, went back and forth a little bit, reached out to Zach and pulled him over, did a little vocalizing, and I just stood there. And I thought my heart was going to break because my whole life I had spent trying to teach the world that Charlie could do things. And here I was standing there trying to show people that he couldn't do things. And then the light bulb went on and I said, you know what? You guys told me to bring him here and that he would speak for himself. And I thought you were crazy, but I think he just did. I think you were right. Now the question is, can you listen to what he had to say? Can you understand it? And that's why Article 12, legal capacity, has language in it about supported decision making. They changed it that day. So again, tell your story. Even if you're pissed off, tell your story. And a woman who was standing in the back of the room wearing a full African headdress, and I mean, she was beautiful, came up to me at the end and said, oh my God, the only reason I'm participating in this is because I thought if I came to America, I would figure out what the magic was. Because we are told that nobody in America has a disability anymore. That if you can't speak, you just get a computer, and all of a sudden you can make yourself clear. And if you can't walk, you can get a power chair, and everything is fine. And she said, but you're telling me you've had all these jobs and you don't have a way for him to communicate. And I said, no, I don't. Charlie used facilitated communication for about a year when he was in fourth grade. And I know he really used it. His teacher, they did it. They didn't tell me about it. They called me up one day and said, Charlie just typed something. You should come over and see it. And I did, and they had him facilitating with little kids who had just, they were refugee kids in Minneapolis. They were from the Hmong population. They didn't speak English. And not only that, they didn't have a written language in their own language. But they were the ones pulling his hand back. And he could type out little messages. And I thought it was cool, and I taught him how to facilitate with his little brother, Eric, who was four and couldn't spell to save his life, but that's who Charlie liked to work with, to spell things. I'm positive it was real. The one day that I forgot to give Charlie lunch, so usually I didn't get him on the bus in the morning. That was my husband's thing. Thank God. Usually Bill got Charlie ready for school. One day I had to do it, and it wasn't lunch, it was breakfast. And I pushed him down the driveway, and I said, Charlie, I'm so sorry, I forgot to give you breakfast. You'll just have to make it till lunchtime. And he got to school, and he was moaning and groaning and, you know, the drill. And so they asked him, Charlie, what's wrong? And he typed, MMFRGTBRKST. Wow. And after, there are no spaces in Charlie's typing. So after they figured out, parsed it out what it meant, they called me up and said, did you forget to give him breakfast? And I said, yeah, I did. And it was the one time in his whole life that he didn't have breakfast. And he reported me. But so how could that not be that he was actually typing that? Who else would have been able to figure out what he was going to type there? Right? Well, then it became this huge political thing, and Connie Chung did a huge story, and people started talking about, oh, it's fake, they're trying to pretend they can cure autism. And Charlie didn't have autism, so, but, you know, it's fake, and Connie Chung was going to do this TV show, and I didn't realize, I thought it was going to be a positive show, so I watched it with Charlie. And the next morning, he took his computer and threw it into the wall. A $10,000 touchscreen on an Apple computer. This was way back that my uncle paid for. And he never would type anymore. Because, you know, that's the real fact about people with complex disabilities. If you don't believe in them, then it's real easy for them to say, well, the heck with you. Now, I would give anything to have had him be able to facilitate, even to say yes and no. But supported decision making for me is about much more than that. You could tell when he was thinking yes or no. Charlie started hiring his own staff when he was 11 years old. He hired Zach, the big Kansas guy. I interviewed Zach with Charlie in our living room and the managers from the agency that served Charlie, and I guess Charlie was older than he was, maybe 16 or 17 years old. And I was talking to Zach and I found out he grew up on the grounds of Beatrice, the largest institution in Nebraska. His dad was the administrator there and his mom also worked there. And I said, Zach, I don't think this is going to work because your values are probably very different from mine. I'm really opposed to institutions. And he said, well, don't hold my dad's values against me. I grew up there, but that doesn't mean I thought it was a good thing. And I still wasn't going to hire him until afterwards when we were doing the meeting. And the manager said to me, well, didn't you notice Charlie wanted to hire Zach? I said, what do you mean Charlie wanted to hire Zach? She said, Sue, haven't you paid any attention? Charlie wheels his chair over to the people that he likes and pats them on their forearm. And that means, okay, this one's okay. And Zach was probably the best assistant, one of the best assistants that Charlie ever had. Charlie also did that to Nate. Nate worked for Charlie for 13 years. 13 years, as long as you were at the Ark. That's a long time. I'm going to see Nate when I go home because he's going to come down and visit. We now call him the brother from another mother in my family. Nate came to interview and I said, well, your job, there's two parts to your job. One, help him rebel against me, right? And two, get him connected in the community. And Nate, whose dad was a Methodist minister, said, well, I'm not very good at rebelling, Mrs. Swenson, and I'm really terrible at connecting in the community because I'm very shy, but I figure it would be good for me to have somebody to work with. I figure maybe it'll help me get more connected in the community if I'm working with Charlie. And for all of those years, Nate described Charlie as his coworker, not his client. And I think that was really important. He said, we work together to integrate the community. So there's no place we go where they don't know it's different now that we're there. Right? And he really believed that in his heart. He wasn't just saying that. And there was never, I mean, he got Charlie a shirt that said staff on the front. Whenever they'd go someplace where that would be in question, Nate would just have on his regular clothes and Charlie would have on the staff shirt. That's what real community inclusion looks like. It's messy. It's not perfect. There's not a plan that you can write that says, oh, here's how this is going to work. But Nate was part of our supported decision-making team. And Zach was part of it, even after Zach wasn't working for Charlie anymore. And Charlie's brothers were part of our supported decision-making team. Near the end of his life, I was trying to get those old muscle biopsies from Minnesota to try to do some medical work with Charlie, and they wouldn't even respond to me because I wasn't Charlie's guardian. So we went out and became guardian. I didn't think Charlie was going to vote, and I didn't think he was going to get married. Although, I think he could have made some woman very happy. He never said a word. And I didn't think he was going to vote. I knew a lot of people who would get an absentee ballot and vote for their kid. I couldn't convince myself to do that. I didn't think that was fair. And I thought, well, if guardianship turns out to be too much, we'll have to get rid of it. We'll have to figure out some way to get rid of it, because I wanted those medical records. Then when Charlie did go into the ICU when he was dying, I said, well, I'm his guardian. And they said, we don't care. You're his mother. We don't need to see any guardianship papers. So I'm not sure if we... Well, I'm pretty sure we wasted all that money to get the guardianship. But Bob Dinnerstein is the one who talked me into doing it. I don't know if you know who Bob is. He's like the world expert on supported decision making. He's at American University. He writes all kinds of, he's in the law school. He writes all these great papers. And he is his sister's guardian. She has mental illness. And what he said to me was, Sue, if you look up the best practices of guardianship, it looks a lot like supported decision making. So if you're going to be a really good guardian, you're not sitting there by yourself making decisions about somebody that you never see. You're talking to them and trying to figure out what they want and talking to other people and figuring out, well, what would we do here that would really make sense for Charlie? And that's the way we practiced it. And Bob's the one who explained to me, if you look up best practices guardianship on Google, there's a whole list of things. You're supposed to get rid of it as soon as you can. You're supposed to minimize the impact of it as much as you can. There's brilliant ideas about how to be a guardian without just being into total control of another human being. So I think with the CRPD, if they had left it the way it was at the beginning, I wouldn't be able to be the president-elect of Inclusion International because it would not be possible. I've been recently to Portugal and South Africa and Geneva, and I'm going to London next week. And the thing I want to tell you is California is really special because you have the Lanterman Act and because you have the Lanterman Coalition. It's really important that you know what your laws and your rights are in California. But California is just like every place else in the world. So there's mothers from Kenya who are struggling with some of the same things that mothers in Fresno are struggling with. They're ignored, they're pushed aside. The disability community sometimes can be non-welcoming to parents in very serious ways. I don't know how we get over that. I've tried punching through it by getting ticked off, and it doesn't work. I don't ever want to take away any agency from a person with a disability who can manage their own life. But I wasn't a parent so that I could try to control or ruin Charlie's life. I mean, really, the goal from age 11 was, if he was going to have any help, help him rebel against me. That was something I believed absolutely in my core. How many people have a plan where that's funded or worked in? And yet, isn't that the key thing about growing up? When you finally become an adult at age 18, aren't you supposed to be able to make up your own mind about what you're wearing and whether you want a beer or not and all of the other things? And Charlie's first beer was purchased for him by Tia Nellis. Do you guys know Tia? Tia's the national president, or was, of the Self-Advocates Becoming Empowered. And she took him for a beer when we were in DC at this meeting and at the Mayflower Hotel, and she came back and said, well, Charlie had his first beer. And I said, Tia, he's 15 years old. But raise your hand if you had a beer when you were 15 years old. And your mother didn't give it to you, did she? But how do we build that into what we're doing with people? So I was telling these stories recently at a meeting in Canada with a bunch of providers, and I said, you know, I knew that Charlie wanted to move out of the house when he would come home at 9 o'clock with Nate from being out in the community. You come into the house, and we put him into this Herman Miller chair that we had because, you know, he could rock around in it and move around in it. It was much more comfortable than his wheelchair. And then he would scoot himself around the house in this typing chair, and he started going over to the front door every day at 9 o'clock when Nate brought him home on the inside of the front door. Now, what does that mean? It means get me out of here, right? But does our supported decision-making allow us to listen for that from the person with profound or complex disabilities? Get me out of here is a really important message. Because if you don't get him out of here soon enough, then what he ends up doing is just, what? His life is just, geez, if I had to live with my mother when I was 25 years old, it would have been a bad thing. But Charlie lived with us until he was 26. And when I had been in the Clinton administration early on, I ran the DD programs. So I had the PNAs, the DD councils, and the UAPs, to the extent that anybody can have those programs. And the state of Maryland wanted to be nice to me. So they said, well, Sue, we're going to build a house for Charlie. And when he grows up and he's ready to move out on his own. And I said, yeah, that's nice. Come back to me when you're ready to build 10 houses. So three people in each house, that's 30 people. When you've got the funding for 10 houses, we'll talk. But lo and behold, they came up with the funding for 10 houses. They worked with the Housing Authority in Montgomery County, Maryland. The Housing Authority bought a house. We were the pilot. They bought a house in a regular neighborhood that was close to the metro. They rehabbed the house so that it was what I call ADA plus, or hyper accessible. It wasn't just a wide door and a grab bar in the bathroom. It was hardened walls. So instead of plasterboard walls, it had plywood with a plaster skim over it So if you ran the wheelchair into it, it didn't punch a hole in it. It had solid doors, same thing, so you don't completely destroy the house. It had a very open plan. So Charlie and his roommate Andre, who had probably more disability than Charlie had, I thought, could get around. They had both had what are called super baths. So the bathroom is big and it has a drain in the floor and it has a tub that you could scoot the wheelchair right up to it and transfer into it. And then it had a shower that was, it was fantastic. And Charlie and his two roommates, Andre was right next to him. Then there was an elevator downstairs. And Justin was downstairs. Justin was an older guy with Down syndrome, older, 2 years older. These three guys all loved music, which is why we thought they would like to be roommates with each other. Problem is, they all like different kinds of music. Justin liked Michael Jackson. Charlie liked opera. He did not learn that from me. And Andre liked the blues. But so they had to, you know, they learned a little bit from each other. But they all rented their room on a Section 8 project voucher. And then the services were brought in, and the idea was the services would be separated from the real estate. So interesting how that changes the relationship with the provider agency when they don't also own the house. It was a great agency. We never changed from them, but you could see it align differently with them. It was no longer, well, Charlie and Andre and Justin are living in our house. It was, we are coming in to provide supports to Charlie, Andre, and Justin. And then there was a live-in staff guy downstairs. Now, the hardest thing for me to do, the advocacy that I failed at, was to get rid of the awake overnight staff. So Andre and Charlie were both rated for awake overnight staff. The house was fully sprinklered, right? There's no way there would have been a fire at night. Nobody in the United States has ever died in a sprinklered house from a house fire. But we could not get rid of this awake overnight staff. The Medicaid agency kept saying, no, it's in the plan, you gotta keep it. Otherwise, there's liability, it's gonna be bad. Finally, I just went into the director and said, do not tell me you cannot bring somebody off the waiting list if we have two awake overnight staff in the house, one for Charlie and one for Andre. So it's 16 hours a day of useless money that you're spending. And they said, well, we don't have any data. So I said, okay, 6 months we tracked what happens with the awake overnight staff. The only times Charlie or Andre woke up at night is when the staff went in and woke them up. Right? Neither of them had seizures. They had seizures, but if they did, it was not a big deal. It was some subclinical thing. And they wouldn't have had a seizure that was so loud or involved that the awake overnight staff would have noticed it over the noise of the TV. But I failed in that. Charlie, still at the time of his death, was rated for awake overnight staff. That's the other thing I wanted to talk to you about a little bit. Empower the people who work with you as advocates to try to give back as much as they can. That day when I stood there and felt myself falling into that CAT scan, the only thing I could think was, I don't want to be one of those people. I didn't want to be a welfare person. I didn't want to be dependent on government to take care of me. And the way I managed that over the course of Charlie's life was to always try to figure out, is there something I can do when I'm advocating for him that will improve life for somebody else? So 10 houses instead of one house. Take this money back from the awake overnight staff, but put it into the waiting list. Don't send it back to the general fund, right? These are things that really matter to parents. Being able to feel like you've made a contribution to the system really matters to parents. What I learned from McKeon early in my career, in different, completely different context, was a way to look at methods that now at this point in my life causes me to disagree with the disability community when people say, oh, there's a social method and a social model and a medical model. First, I don't think people know what a model is. Second, I think that's a false dichotomy. So I always start with a medical method, and I think most parents do, and I think most systems do. And by a medical method, I mean I have a lab coat and some testing equipment and a clipboard. I'm going to test you and find out what's wrong with you, and then I'm going to fix it. Right? Now, you can do that if you're auditing a system or meeting a person or designing an IEP, but it's all about fixing something. It's great. If you need it, it's great, but it doesn't feel great. It's just like, what do you mean, what's wrong with me? And again, let's go back to all human beings are born free and equal. The second method, when the medical method fails, and it always does, because I don't know anybody who used to have autism, do you? Is to come to you and say, I still have a clipboard, but I'm a rehab engineer, and I'm going to assess the things that you can't do that society wants you to do, and I'm going to accommodate you so that you can do those things. So we'll get you a wheelchair, a built-up spoon so you can feed yourself, some shoes with Velcro on them, whatever it takes so that you can be accommodated to have a job, live as independently as possible, whatever that is. And that's great, but raise your hand if when you got up this morning you thought, gee, I can't wait to get out there and do what society wants me to do today. So rehab and accommodation all works for stuff that government and society feels good about paying for, but if you say, I want to go hang gliding, I don't care if I die, I want to go hang gliding, I got no way to help you because that's not something I can accommodate. Now, if we shift to a rights method, I come to you, I might still have a clipboard, but I come to you and I say, what is it you want to do? And that's supposedly what an IPP is, or an IEP, or an IFSP, or all of the Ps, right? We're going to come to you, and we're going to try to figure out what turns you on. For my Charlie, the opera thing, he used to have a prescription when he was a little tiny guy to watch Sesame Street, because there was so much change of perspective and color, and they thought it might engage his vision more. So, but sometimes on Saturdays, I wouldn't get there the minute Sesame Street ended. And in those days, Live from the Met used to come on in Minneapolis right after Sesame Street. And if I didn't get him there to get him away, he would start crying when I took him away from the opera. So I thought, okay, dude, you want to sit in front of the TV? You got it. But he loved it. And his whole life, if he was upset or distressed for any reason, the DVD of one of the operas that he loved was the answer to that. He cried in all the right places. He tracked the subtitles. I asked Temple Grandin about this once. I said, why? I know so many kids who like opera. And she said, why do you think that is? And she said, people with autism like to see a picture, see the words, and hear the words all at the same time. And I thought, oh, I can turn on the closed captioning on television. So whenever the TV is on, there's going to be captions running that he can. And I think he could read. I can't prove it. If somebody said to me, you know, you have to come in and prove that he has the capability to read, I couldn't have done that. But why else would you track in that way? So, what do you want to do? I want to listen to opera. I want to have a beer. I want to go out with Zach. I want to go out with Nate. When he had the last 2 years of his IEP delivered at the University of Maryland, this was before Think College. He wasn't signed up for any college courses. But he was signed up to, A, deliver coffee to the graduate students in special education at the University of Maryland. That's Maggie McLaughlin's program, so there were really good people. And Maggie said to me, Sue, most of these people have never met anybody with a complex disability before. So they thought he was there to help them get coffee, but he was really there to blow their mind. Right? And that was a giving back. That was Charlie giving back. And he also worked at the opera workshop, handing out programs. Sort of. His staff did some of that. And then the rest of his IEP was Charlie would go swimming every day because he could walk when he was in the water waist deep. And he couldn't walk otherwise. This is telling me to stop talking. Not quite, I have a few minutes left. And then the rest of his IEP said Charlie will hang out and watch girls. Hundred percent success with that goal. 100%. His best IEP was in fourth grade. It said, and I don't quote the whole thing to you, it said, Charlie will be included in the regular education classroom 95% of the time with 98% accuracy. They made me change it because the monitors were coming in, but that was a great IEP, going back to trust. So the principal and the teacher and everybody trusted everybody else and me, and they just tried stuff with him, and it was great. So the third method is rehab. Sorry, I forgot the fourth method. The fourth method is a social method, which says, how are we going to make it so that everybody has the health care that they need, the rehab that they need, has access to their rights, has self-determination training, self-advocacy training, has someone who can help them navigate what supported decision making is and how that works. How do we make sure that everybody has all of those things? So it's not just it's not the individual education plan or individual service plan or whatever the I stands for. It's how do we figure this out so that we give back? There's a poem online, which I won't read to you, but I want you to look it up. It was written by Nate, Charlie's assistant, and he wrote it in, I guess it was 2005, when we had the first Alliance for Full Participation meeting in DC. And Nate was a very religious guy. I am not a person of faith, but I have seen that faith bolsters and strengthens all kinds of people in my life, and I respect it. Nate is a person of faith, and he wrote this lovely poem called My Friend Charlie. If you Google My Friend Charlie Jubilee, it will pop out at you, and you can read it. But Nate, in that poem, explains how working with Charlie changed his life and gave him skills and changed who he was. And yeah, we still need to work on minimum wage, but we need to start recognizing that everybody is connected. I wanted to mention, if you're closing two developmental centers with a lot of land, why don't you think about taking a little bit of the land and building communities? Now, I know that sounds terrible. I'm not talking about gated communities. I'm talking about intentional communities where people can live in multi-generational models with their mother-in-law or their aging parent or their disabled son or daughter, or just live there because it's a nice place and it's really accessible from the ground up, and have low-income housing for people with disabilities who need a place where they can live independently while they receive their supports, and also have low-income housing for people who either are working or have worked as direct support professionals. Because we know those are people we want in our communities, and we should be supporting them to do that. I think it's been done in Santa Barbara. Orange County. Well, if you're interested in talking to some designers about that, I think, you know, it's possible for us to be thinking that way. How do we really make new communities? And San Francisco can use a little bit of that thinking too right now, couldn't they? Especially about the low-income housing part. Anyway, I'm sorry I'm not reading Charlie's poem to you. I want to read, though, what Jefferson said. I read this at the 40th anniversary of IDEA. And Jefferson, have you been to the Jefferson Memorial in D.C.? So he wrote this 40 years after he wrote the Declaration of Independence. I am not an advocate for frequent changes in laws and constitutions, but laws and institutions must go hand in hand with the progress of the human mind. As that becomes more developed, more enlightened, as new discoveries are made, new truths discovered, and manners and opinions change, with the change of circumstances, institutions must advance also to keep pace with the times. We might as well require a man to wear the coat which fitted him when he was a boy as ask civilized society to remain ever under the regimen of their barbarous ancestors. He was counting himself as a barbarous ancestor, I think, when he wrote this. 40 years after the Declaration of Independence. So when people say, oh, I'm an originalist, I have to go back, you know, and go back to the Constitution, and I'm not going to pay any attention to anything that's happened in recent years, they're just flipping Jefferson the bird when they say that. We have an evolving society. We have a society with new values and new ideas, and you are a big part of that. You have been an engine for that, creating better and better communities and societies for people in California. And please keep doing it. We need it. You are the place where the sun sets, but where the ideas rise. Thank you.
Thank you. Lou Brown says hey.
Lou Brown.
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.